let me thank everybody for coming and sharing tonight as we continue in our study of 1 Corinthians and chapter 1. Last week we did verses 1 through 9. Tonight we're going to do verses 10 through 17. If you were not here last week, if you could go to the church app, the Emmanuel Temple, the handout from last week is there, as well as the handout from this week. So if you've got some friends you want to share it with, they're more than welcome there. It's good to see Brother Justin, who works for the federal government, been here last week in church, and then been here back again. So let's keep him lifted in prayer. He still has to go to work. And last Friday got a check stub with said 0.00. He's not hungry. If he was hungry, we'd take up a love offering for him. But he's not hungry. But if it keeps going, then we're going to have to do that. I only know of one other member of our church who works for the federal government. I will reach out to her and see how she is doing as well. Let's continue to keep several members lifted in prayer. We have members who are traveling. We have some members who having some health challenges. We got some members who are going to the doctor on tomorrow, and so they need our prayers. Again, those who are worshiping with us virtually, let me encourage you to go to our app, The Emmanuel Temple with the I, and in the sermon notes section, there is a Bible study handout dated January the 15th, 2019, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 10 through 17. That's our lesson for tonight. Let's have a word of prayer. Gracious, wonderful, kind God, we thank you for this day. We thank you, God, for another time of sharing. We ask that you would continue to lead us and guide us and direct us. And we ask it all, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Anybody have any questions about last week before we move to this week? Questions about 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. Okay. Let's go to, let's keep going down. Tonight we're going to deal with verses 10 through 17. Let's read it. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And some things I want you to write in your margins. These are key words that I want you to remember. Brothers and sisters. So write that down if you have your Bibles. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're reading from the New Revised Standard Version. By the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you. My brothers and sisters, what I mean is that each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you, or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except for Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not see whether I baptized anyone else. Verse 17, for Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross, Brother Brandon, you close that door, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. Okay. The word of God for the people of God. The people said, thanks be to God. So, next slide. So, here we have, y'all, the first issue Paul deals with. Remember I said last week that this is Paul writing a letter to the people at Corinth. And I told you about what Corinth was and all of those things. But the first issue Paul deals with is divisions in an authoritative tone. Christian slaves who belonged to the establishment of a lady called Chloe visited Corinth, and they came back with a sorry tale of dissension and disunity. And the question I want to ask tonight, what do people say when they come to our church? If it's not what God would have us to do, then we must be serious about changing it as soon as possible. I praise God, Reverend James, one of our ministerial staff persons who also teaches at Broward College in a religion class, invited her students to come to church, and they sent her a glowing report about their experiences, from the warm and friendliness to the preaching to the worship to the music to everything about our church. Somebody ought to say amen. The problem is there are a lot of churches that are not together. And so because they're not together, it's evident in the people who sit in the pews. Okay? Let's go back to the slide, Beyonce. So, now, as we keep digging, questions. So the Greek word suggests a tune-up, an adjustment that restores the church to its proper condition. Sounds like reset to me. So it seems as if this church, like other churches, including us, needs to hit the reset button and go back to what is what default setting. Okay? Next slide. So the Greek phrase also means a coming together in both mind and thought. Look, let's go back to the verse 10, Sister Beyonce. Look at how Paul addresses them. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement and there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same purpose. Now look at this. If you about to fuss somebody out, are you going to say flowery phrases first? Or you just going to what? Fuss somebody out. Paul is getting ready to rebuke them, but he chastises them in the name of Jesus. What would happen if you had an issue with somebody and you went to them in the name of Jesus? No finger pointing, no neck rolling. Let me get this straight. Let me get this person straight. Let me clap back. None of that. In the name of Jesus. Maybe, go back to my slide, Beyonce. So, the next one. So, he softens the rebuke as one who has no other emotion than love. When we communicate with folks, we must make sure that we have the spirit of Jesus Christ in not only what we say, but how we say it. I used to pastor a church, and I had a senior saint member that I had to constantly check her and tell her that you can't just roll up on young folks and say whatever you think you should say to them without having a relationship with them. Because young folks nowadays will cuss even grandma out. And so, when we have issues with people, how are we coming across with them? Now, I'm going to say this. Brother Justin, I hate texting. I hate it with a passion. I hate texting. I would rather pick up the phone and talk to someone, and I would rather, be honest, talk to them face to face, because I think a lot of things can get misconstrued in text. And the challenging part is we're dealing with a generation who only knows about texting. Before cell phones, if you need to see somebody in the house, you went to wherever they was, or you called up there. Now, can you come downstairs? What do you want to eat? We about to leave. Am I making sense, y'all? So I think how we communicate with each other, if we are believers, can we agree to disagree? And not fall out? Can we not have a bitterness between us when we don't agree on something? Am I making sense, y'all? If we're really going to live in the kingdom, that's how you operate in the kingdom. Now, if you're going to operate in the world, then you're going to clap back. Questions, comments? Y'all mighty quiet. So, Paul is saying that we are fellow Christians and we should live in mutual love. So, I got some questions tonight. How many issues in churches could be squashed immediately if we understood this? If we understood that I don't have any other agendas but seeing you be the person who God wants you to be, and I want you to have any other agendas but seeing me be the person God wants me to be. But our problem is we don't think that way because we think somebody got an agenda that ain't God's agenda. Am I making sense, y'all? And sometimes we construe God's agenda with our agenda. Questions, comments? Y'all ain't talking. Yes, ma'am, says Andrea. Huh? Go ahead, Beyonce.
There's a question back here.
Okay.
Someone would like you to expand on that, basically saying, go further in your explanation as to...
What you said, give Angie the mic and ask, she can answer her own question. Ask her own question.
Explain that last thing, your agenda is God's agenda, and...
God, I think sometimes... So remember last year, y'all, we had this whole series on hearing from God, and we had to make a distinction that just because what we want is may not necessarily be what God wants for us, and how there are things that God is never going to contradict God's self. God's never going to do something to tell us to go against God's word. And so because of that, there are some things that we think God was saying to us, but it may not have been God saying to us. It may have been what we wanted God to say to us. I've constantly say this, and I said this last week when I was teaching a workshop. Prophecy comes as confirmation of what the Lord has already told you. Prophecies just don't come fall out the air and you have no clue, no inclination. That ain't prophecy. That ain't the word God has for you. That may word be for somebody else, but that word ain't for you. Because prophecy simply comes as confirmation of what the Lord has already told you. You just didn't believe it. You just didn't want to hear it. You sent God a voicemail. But that word, and part of the reason why you see people become so emotional when prophecies, when prophets come and give them a word, is because they know this person don't know me from a can of paint. This person ain't never been in my house. He don't know my cell phone. He ain't been in my text. He ain't been in my DM. None of that. But this person has a word for you. Am I making sense, y'all? Okay. Questions. Other questions. Yes, ma'am. So let me add to that, Beyonce. So as we're unfolding, I need to know that I'm gonna use one of the members who just walked in as an example. Sister Tony Gibbs. All right. So we were in South Africa, and we were Brother Justin trying to convert some dollars to rand. And so y'all know me, I'm trying to find where is the most biggest bang we can get for our buck. So we found Brother Man on the corner who had all the money. And so I'm trying to get this together, and Sister Tony Gibbs said, Pastor, let me do this. Now, I resisted at first, but then it kicked in. She is an accountant. She does know how to handle money. So, guess what I did? I let her handle it. Now, that's mutual love. That's a disagreement. We didn't fall out. We got all the money right. And I gave her the money after I went to go talk to Brother Man. And then gave her the money and let her distribute the what? The money. You understand, Sister Angie? So, it's saying... I know you're not going to do anything to harm me. I know you have my best interest at heart. So I can receive something from you, even if I don't like it, because it's coming from a place of what? Love. The challenging part is we don't have those kind of relationships with everybody in the church. And if the church had those relationships throughout all churches, then you would not have as many disagreements in churches, because people will receive stuff because they know it's coming from a place of what? Love. The challenging part is we mix up God's word for our word. And then we try to preface what the Lord told me. No. No. And that's why I'm careful of what the Lord, if the Lord told you, he can tell me. Again, prophecy comes as confirmation of what the Lord has already said to me, or what the Lord spoke to me in my spirit, or it could have been in a dream, or it could have been somewhere I saw some kind of sign, something that when this prophecy comes is confirmation. So to take it another step further, Sister Angie, when I wear my emotions on my sleeves, and when I think everybody's out to get me, I can't receive from other folks, even if it's coming in love. I mean, I'm gonna pick on Sister Singleton. Sister Singleton is the sweetest person in the house tonight. Somebody ought to say amen. One of the sweetest people we got in the church. Somebody ought to say amen. If you can't receive something from her, that says a lot about you, does not say about her. Our problem is, Sister Angel, we think people have some hidden agendas. And I agree with you, sometimes they do. That's why we got to have a what? A spirit of discernment. The Bible says you got to try the spirit what? By the spirit. Just because they ain't in the church don't mean they got. That's why Paul is dealing with this tonight, about divisions, disunity. Beyonce, your question. I answered it? Okay, next slide. So we have Corinth, y'all. The church at Corinth. So Paul receives information that there are quarrels, and it's ugly and sinful. So Paul uses two phrases. He tells them to make up their differences. The phrase he uses is a regular one used of two hostile parties reaching an agreement. He wishes to knit together. It's a medical word used of knitting together bones that have been fractured or joining together a joint that has been dislocated. This disunion is unnatural and must be cured for the sake of the health and efficiency of the body of Christ, also known as church. If you break a bone, and if the bone is not set properly, the bone will not heal properly. And that's why you see in athletes sometimes, after they break a bone and they set it, and if it's not set properly, if it doesn't heal properly, the doctor will go break it again and reset it. Because it's not going to be healthy if the bone does not heal what? Properly. So our problem, y'all, is sometimes our divisions and the disunity means there's going to be some pain because there's some broken what? Bones. But in order for God to heal us, sometimes it hurts first. Questions, comments? Questions, comments? Questions, comments? Okay. So, Paul identifies four parties in the church at Corinth. These parties have not broken away from the church. For the moment, divisions remain within it. He uses the word schemata, where we get our word schism, which is a word for tears in a garment. When the church is not on one accord, we look raggedy and unkempt to others and even to ourselves. If I'm walking around with a hole in my pants, and if this is my church, why didn't somebody tell me? Huh? No. I'm not talking about holes in my jeans. I'm talking about holes in places that shouldn't be holes. So if I rip the back of my pants, I got fat, I sat down, tried to sit down too quick, and I don't feel the air breeze, air conditioning coming back down. And if I walk around like that and nobody tells me, what does that say about me and what does that say about our church? Because that's what disunity looks like, y'all, in the church. It looks like a bunch of people walking around with raggedy clothes and nobody saying nothing. You don't care that much about me to tell me my slip is hanging? Funny story. There's a preacher who named Dr. Claudette Copeland. I think y'all, some of y'all remember her. She tells a story about when she was in the military. Brother Brandon, she had her cocktail dress on at a party and walking around. She's an officer greeting all the people. They not telling her that her slip is hanging all down by her ankles. She does not feel it. She just walking around. Hey, everybody. Hey, everybody. Hey, how you doing? You doing all right? Hey, everybody. Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm just looking. I know I'm cute. Hey, y'all. How y'all doing? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know I'm fine. Uh-huh. Look at me. All right. Not knowing that her slip is what? Hanging. There's nothing worse than I seeing a sister hanging out with her friends with lipstick on her teeth and they don't even have the guts to tell her. I'm convinced, y'all, Aretha Franklin did not have any friends. The reason she didn't have any friends because her friends would have told her, girl, I know you think you look good, but that's not for you. It does not fit your body size. I want some real friends to say, you know what? That may be cute, but that, no, no, that ain't. No, don't do that. Don't wear that. Yes, ma'am.
Question online says, does it always have to hurt first?
Does healing always have to hurt first? Okay. I'm going to tell this story, Sister Beyonce. I was in the fifth grade. I was playing football. Cut my leg. Blood is flowing everywhere. My mama rushes me to the doctor. In order for the doctor to give me stitches, he had to give me a shot in my leg to numb the pain. It had to hurt before he could stitch up my leg. If I said, don't give me the shot, it would have hurt even worse as he was stitching my leg up. Okay? Did I answer the question? Okay? Sister Angie.
I have a question to the, if they're your friend, they will let you know that something's wrong. What happens if you do let them know in a nicely way and that individual get offended and tell you, oh, you just jealous? Or, you know what I'm saying? So how do we try to show somebody that it doesn't look right without our feelings getting hurt because they think they look right?
Are we led by the Spirit in not only what we say, but how we say it?
Yeah, I mean.
No. So what I'm saying is, and what I mean by that, are we praying about what words to say? When is the right time? Where is the right time? Or are we just saying it? Because if we're not led by the Spirit, the best thing can turn out to be the worst thing. We've got to be really praying, God, my friend is looking raggedy. Do I need to say this now, or do I need to say this at another time? God, I need to know what to say, the exact words to say, and how to say it. If I know my friend is defensive, that's why Paul, before he chastises them, he uses a cause, a phrase, my brothers and sisters, to try to let them know I'm coming in the name of what? Jesus. Not, hey, look here, your stuff messed up. Even if that's who you are, you may can't be that way when you're dealing with this issue. It makes sense? Some people who are married will tell you they don't even receive stuff from their spouses. Ain't that right, Brother Jimmy? All right, go ahead, Beyonce.
Does that also have to deal with, like what you were talking about last week with the relationship? You have to have a relationship with God to hear it. You have to have a relationship with that friend to hear it. My question is, if the relationship is perceived to be that of, mm-hmm, I could tell you could tell me, mm-hmm, but then they don't receive it well, then what has happened? How do we explain it as humans? What has happened?
It may not be you. It may be that person. and that person may not be in a posture of receiving. It may be the right thing to say. It may be what they need to hear, but they may not be in a place of what? Receiving. I'll give you a biblical example. Joseph, in Old Testament Genesis, has a dream that his brothers, his older brothers, are going to come down and what? Bow down to him. They're going to need him. And they said, so what you saying? We going to be your servants? And which leads to a vicious cycle of them throwing their brother in a pit, lying to their father about what happened, him getting out of the pit, being sold into slavery, then going to prison, then being in prison, the Lord still using him, and then a person's wife who wants Joseph, he does not want her, lies on him, goes back to prison, eventually gets out of prison, makes it to the palace, but that happens years later. Maybe part of our problem, Beyonce, is we want the Joseph of the palace and not the Joseph of the process. Because the Joseph of the palace only became that Joseph because of the process. We want to fast forward and circumvent our process. So maybe we had to figure out that maybe this person is not the friend we thought this person is. Or maybe we figured out this person is not in a place they're receiving. So maybe, just like Joseph, just because you got a dream don't mean you need to share the dream. The Bible says the vision comes for an appointed time. You got to be careful where you share your dream. You got to be careful. Everybody can't handle it. And I say this, I told one of my friends the other day, and I found this out for myself. Everybody is not a builder. Some people want something already ready made. Some people are willing to be on the ground floor and help something, create something out of nothing. The key is you got to discern who's a builder and who's a person who's ready made. Because if you try to put a ready-made person in a building situation, it's not going to work, because they're going to be frustrated, because they're going to think, well, it should be this, this, and that, and not understanding that we ain't there. We need you to help put this all the way together. Am I making sense, y'all? So that's why even in relationships, you got to figure out, as you're engaging in a relationship, is this person a builder or this person wants something ready-made? It's no need of you frustrating yourself trying to hook up with a brother who is a builder, and you want some brother who's ready made. You're gonna be mad and angry and frustrated, because you're gonna be like, he should be. No, that's not who he is. He is a what? Builder. He needs to see stuff evolve to this point. And he should be here. No, he shouldn't. That's not who he is at this particular club. Questions, comments? You got more questions, Beyonce? All online. Yes, ma'am, Sister Pam. Praise the Lord for somebody asking a question.
Mm-hmm. Go from being a builder to,
you can eventually, but it's going to take time. I don't know how long that time is.
And can you go back in the reverse? Can you go from being ready made to a builder?
You can, but it's harder, because you've seen the finished product and you're going to start all over from scratch. The hardest thing is the going from something ready made to starting all over. I preached a sermon Sunday in California called Starting All Over Again. And from Noah and his sons, when Noah got drunk, naked, God used him to start all over again. He started the world all over again. Out of all the people God could have used, he decided to use Noah. The hardest part, Noah is a prime example of somebody who had it all and had to start all over again. Noah had never built the ark. He had never built anything. As a matter of fact, Noah had never seen water. And God gives him this word, it's going to rain. So not only you must build something, but you must gather all of the animals and get them into something that they've never seen before. I'm preaching now. That means Noah had vision, and I think Helen Keller says the most dangerous thing in the world is have sight but no vision. And there are a lot of people who can see, but they have no vision. Okay, go ahead, Pam.
So can you say the same thing about Job? Because Job had everything and lost it.
Lost it all.
And then God gave him
double for his trouble.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. The hard part is going from the top to the bottom and then starting all over. I mean, people who've been divorced can testify to that. You had the white picket fence, you had the dog running around the backyard, you had the chicken in the pot, and one day, love don't live here anymore. And you gone from a deluxe apartment in the sky to living below the level that you lived. You had to change your whole lifestyle. So you've gone from establishment to starting all over. And the hardest part, I would say, Pam, I found is that so many people in relationships would stay in abusive situations because they are scared to start all over. I'm convinced so many pastors and leaders will stay in abusive relationships with organizations because they're scared to start all over. They do not, I may be frustrated, I may be mad, I may be angry, I may not be able to do minister the way I want to do it, but at least I know I'm going to get paid. I know I got a parking spot in the parking lot. I know the people going to come to church. The hardest thing to do that I've ever done in my life is start all over. The hardest thing. Because you don't know if the people going to show up every Sunday. Questions, comments? Okay, so we're in Corinth. These three great figures of the church, Paul, Cephas, also known as Peter, and Apollos, they had nothing to do with the divisions, and there were no dissensions between them. Without their knowledge and without their consent, their names had been appropriated by these Corinthian factions. Sometimes our supporters are a bigger problem than those who are openly hostile. Sometimes our supporters are a bigger problem than those who are openly hostile. What do I mean? I mean, Sister Angie, sometimes in efforts to protect people, the people who are protecting the people they're supposed to protect are not only mean, angry, and upset, but they don't let information get to them that they need because they think they're trying to protect them. And it really hurts them more than it helps them. So for me, Sister Angie, I'm the type of leader that I want people to be brutally honest with me. I've already told y'all, Sister Tony and I had a disagreement in South Africa. I mean, there's nothing that Brother Justin and I will have a conversation with and I don't agree with it. He'd say, Pastor, you the pastor and everything, but I don't agree with that. And you need to do such and such, such and such, and you need to do such and such, such. Now, if I was a leader who just wanted people to tell me what I wanted to hear, it'd be a different kind of situation. I want people to tell me, Pastor, I don't agree with that. These are the reasons why. And it comes from a place of love. But you can't receive that unless you got relationship. Did you got to know that I'm down for you and I got to know you down for me? Like I said before, you can only receive stuff people for you in a relationship with. Sister Angie.
Okay, let's get out of the church world or okay. Whatever. What if you real homies with somebody, right?
Right, right.
And then you see the other half sliding with somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
And you know you real homies, and you let your homie know, yo dog, check this out. And then your homie
gets mad at you.
Get mad at me, and then go tell
They boo. Such and such saw me at the movies with somebody that wasn't you. So maybe you'd be like Eddie Murphy, it wasn't me. No, I think Sister Angie, in relationships, you have to tread very carefully. And just because, again, you may not be the person who's assigned to reveal that information. And just because you think you should, just because it's the right thing, does not mean you need to reveal that information. And you're not being any less of a friend, because if the truth be told, you know your friend, and you know your friend ain't gonna believe you anyway. So why you even put yourself through that kind of pressure?
Because they asked me after they found out that they were sliding with
that somebody. It's a difference in asking afterwards than asking before.
Okay.
Hindsight is always 20/20 vision. I always know what I did after I messed up. Am I making sense, y'all? Okay. So here we are. So sometimes our supporters are a bigger problem than those who are openly hostile. So the next slide. So Apollos. So these three people. Apollos was a native of Alexandria in Egypt. It was a Greek city. He's a learned man with thorough knowledge of scriptures who spoke with great fervor and taught about Jesus accurately. But Apollos was followed by a group of Greeks who were always trying to find the obscure meanings in the simplest passages. There are some people in church who always want to be technical. You doing a Daniel fast. Or as somebody posted on social media the other day, if you fasting and still getting drunk, if you fasting and still doing all these other things, then maybe you need to go and eat. Not understanding that the fast is not about the fast. The fast is simply about, am I connecting with God in new, different ways? And if that means I break the fast, I break it, and the next day I get right back up, I don't beat myself up, because have I connected with God in these 14 days that I had not connected with God before? The legalistic says you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do this, you can't do that. Are you the fasting police? Some folks always want to find the hidden technical things in the text to trap you. The Pharisees were that. They were always trying to get somebody in trouble. Don't deal with the plank in their own eye. They always want to see everybody else stuff raggedy. Questions, comments? Okay, so next slide. So then Peter or Cephas, we all know Peter. Upon this rock I build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against me. This faction was Jews, the faction that followed Peter. They sought to teach that Christians must still observe the Jewish law. They were legalistic and who exalted law and belittled grace. These are karma people, y'all. How are you going to belittle grace? These are people saying Jesus said, I did not come to what? Break the law. I came to what? Fulfill the law. Y'all can't do all of these 100 some commandments. I'm going to give you two. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. If you do those two things, you're going to do everything else. So if I'm throwing shade on my neighbor, am I loving my neighbor as I love myself? If I know my friend is gaining weight and is getting unhealthy, am I a friend by telling them you need to do some dieting, or giving them a gym membership? Or do I need to say in love, maybe let's start walking together? Not just go text them Sister Patty Cook number and like, all right, y'all need to go holler at her. Okay? Am I making sense, y'all? Love the Lord all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and I love my neighbor as I love my what? Self. So that means when I'm working with people, do I treat them the way that the Spirit is leading me to treat them? And if truth be told, if you get to that point, then you're growing in grace. If you're not, then you're still in first grade, and we need to try to get you to second grade this year. Because we're tired of seeing you in first grade. We want you to what? Grow in grace. Questions, comments. So the purists were proud that they followed only Jesus. It was a small, rigid sect who claimed that they were the only true Christians in Corinth. Their real fault was not in saying that they belonged to Christ, but in acting as if Christ belonged to them. You know, these are self-righteous folks. They the only one going to heaven. Okay? Everybody else going to hell. If you dance, you're going to hell. And drink wine, you're going to hell. You go to movies on Sunday, you're going to hell. Self-righteous group. How many self-righteous folks we know? Question. You got a question, Beyonce? Mm-hmm. Self-righteous. Nobody ain't going to heaven but you. Self-righteous. Questions, comments. So the question I ask, have things really changed now? We have fights, schisms inside churches and between churches. Now, we got to also remember that some people are just disagreeable, fault-finding, and proud. Some people ain't going to change until God moves on their heart to change. Because they can hear the same words you hear and hear it in a completely different way. Go back to my text. Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart. The reason he put heart first is because heart tells your head what to do. That's why when people perform open heart surgery on a person, when they give you a new heart, you get the cringe, you get the cravings and the appetite that the person's heart you received. And that's why some of us need to have open heart surgery and ask God to put his heart in us. Beyonce.
A question asked online, what are some examples of modern-day purists?
Modern-day?
Purists?
Spirits?
Purists.
Purists. The churches that make women have skirts down to their ankles. Women can't wear makeup. Women can't wear earrings. Now, this is Andrea, my Old Testament professor said this, and I never forget it. Why are all the rules against women? Women can't do this. Women can't do that. Women can't do this. Women can't do that. So why are all the rules against women? Not understanding that the Bible was written in a very male patriarchal society, male dominated society. Purists. When you call the woman caught in the act of adultery out in front of everybody, but you don't call the man. Now, last time I checked, Bro Justin. Okay, I forgot we got kids in town. All right, yeah. So, yeah, okay. Purists. They follow the letter of the law more than the love behind the law. They take scriptures and run with them. Women should be what? Seen and not what? Heard. And take it out of context that Paul was dealing with some specific issues at a specific church that they had some fighting. So this was not a blanket statement about all women. There were some specific issues at a specific church. Questions? So while there are others, y'all, who are loving, peacemaking, and seeking common good. We can't allow divisions and disputed points make us fight each other. Do we all know that we have all these different denominations because of fights? Because of schisms? The AME church was started because of what? Racism. They wanted to go pray at the altar one day, and the white people said, no, you gotta pray, and Richard Allen and Absalom Jones and said, we won't bother you no more, let us finish our prayer. Racism. Sociological issues. But there are other churches who were started over what? Theological issues. Do we know that the Assemblies of God came out of the Church of God in Christ? And the reason the Assembly of God came out of the Church of God in Christ was because they didn't want black people to ordain them. So they started a whole nother Pentecostal denomination called Assemblies of God. I was paying attention in the African-American church history, Sister Andre. I was paying attention in the African-American church history during the coaching class. Okay? Schisms. Martin Luther starts the Protestant Reformation because people in the Catholic Church were paying to be repented from their sins. Called them indulges. You had to pay this amount. And the priest would tell you to go say 3 Hail Marys, 4 Our Fathers, and go on your way. But you had to what? Pay. So Martin Luther said, no, I'm going to have all of these issues that I got with the Catholic Church and nail them to the door. And that's how you got the Protestant Reformation. And out of that, the Lutheran Church, the Presbyterian Church, the Baptist Church, the Methodist Church, all came from that. Questions, comments? If we really want to go way back there, the people in the Holy Land are still fighting the same fights they fought 2,000 plus years ago over land and over issues. Why can't we, in the words of Rodney King, can't we just all get along? I can agree to disagree with you and not fall out. Okay, you don't believe in speaking in tongues. Well, I do. Okay, can we, do we got to fight? You don't believe in women in ministry or women in leadership. Okay, but I do. Can't we come together on some common causes? Jeremiah Wright, when he was talking about the Million Man March, if y'all remember correctly, it was a lot of churches that were not with it at all. Jeremiah Wright says that my theology should not dictate my sociology. The way I view God, because he said, when Rodney King got beat, they didn't ask him, do you pray to Jesus or do you pray to Buddha? Do you read the final call? But they just saw a black man getting beaten and people needed to raise up. Am I making sense, y'all? Questions. Okay, so if we can agree to disagree on minor points, but unite around Jesus, our common Lord. Next slide. Paul shows us the foolishness of divisions. He says there are no such divisions in Christ, and none of these leaders is worth fighting about. None of them died to bring us salvation, and none of their names are used in baptism. Paul says God didn't send him to surround himself with a group of personally baptized, loyal disciples that follow his every whim. Paul is saying he seeks to point the lost to Christ, not fuss about personal preferences and ministry styles. How many churches are really fighting and fussing about personal preferences and ministry styles? I don't like that. And Paul is saying, Paul said this, I want to be all things to all people to win some for Christ. For the Jews, I became a Jew. For the Gentiles, I became a Gentile. Because the most important thing is, are these people being directed to Christ? Or are we trying to make them what we want them to be? And I say this, Sister Andrea, at a workshop several times. You can be a good AME and not be a disciple of Jesus Christ. But if you are a disciple of Jesus Christ, you will be a good AME. Because disciples are what? Followers of the way. Disciple means learner. I want to learn. So if I'm so, and I often tell people, you know, you're real AME. But are you a disciple? Do you know who Jesus is? Are you in a close, committed, monogamous, intimate relationship with Jesus? Questions, comments? Okay, all right, let me press on. Y'all ain't asking no more questions. Okay, Paul is not belittling baptism, but it was not in the name, but it was into the name of Jesus. The Greek word here implies the closest possible connection. It means that we are not only possessed by Christ, but in some strange way identified with him. Why are we baptized? Because we want to be possessed by Christ, but some strange way identified with him, because he was baptized. And baptism is an outward expression of what has already happened on the what? Inside. So it doesn't matter if it's sprinkling, doesn't matter if it's pouring, doesn't matter if it's immersion. It's an outward expression of what has already happened on the inside. Questions, comments? Yes, ma'am. Praise the Lord for a question.
Thank you. So you kept using friends, you know, friends as far as relationship, if you're in a relationship with a friend. But in churches and just everywhere, you're not just going to be friends with everyone. Mm-hmm. You talked about growing in grace. Mm-hmm. Just as we grow in grace, we have to grow into relationships mm-hmm. with people. But my question is, would you want, because you said about, you know, a female sitting there with lipstick on her teeth, wouldn't you want somebody who's not your friend to say, hey, brother, you got, you know, there's a hole in your pants, or, you know, some tissue is on your shoe or something like that?
I think I make this statement, Sister Andrea, that I think people come to church because of relationships, and I think people come to church seeking relationships. The key is, are we creating an atmosphere where relationships can flourish, can thrive? If we are, then those things can be handled properly. If we're not, then the little smallest slight can be misconstrued and taken the wrong way. I'm going to use Sister Angie. I'm going to pick on her. I think Sister Angie and I have a good relationship. She might talk about me behind my back, but I think we got a good relationship. And I probably don't tell Sister Angie enough how much I appreciate her and how I value her input. But if I'm going to you asking your input, for me that says I value your opinion. Now, I'm not championing jumping from the roof, but I need you. I value your opinion. I think to me there's other ways that I try to show, express I appreciate you. The challenging part is, Sister Andrea, if you're not in a relationship with people, and you got your own baggage, you bring that baggage. I mean, let me say this. If you and I are in a relationship, when we first meet, I'm just dating your representative. I'm just dating your Mary Kay representative. I don't know you, but this is your Mary Kay representative, okay? And you don't know me. You just my representative, okay? As we develop in a relationship and it grows closer, I still bring baggage from other relationships. I think what happens a lot in churches is that we have never healed from the baggage from previous churches. And because of that, we bring some of that a misunderstanding can be completely taken and gone left field. Particularly when you don't know the person, particularly when and when you know the person's heart. And the person has never shown you that the person is malicious or vindictive or evil, blah, 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 blah. All right. Okay, I need it. Okay, so Sister Andre, you can't be my, I can't use you no more, and I can't use Sister Pam no more because Brother Jimmy said I can't use them no more. Okay? All right. So the challenging part is, Sister Andre, how do we create an environment where we can all grow in grace? I think I said this the first Sunday. Can we create an environment where shame is eradicated? That I can expose my wounds even when the pus is still exuding out? Because that means my wound is healing. And that means I'm willing to be vulnerable enough to show you where I'm growing in grace. The challenging part is in this social media age is you can say one thing and it can go viral because it's taken out of what? Context. Yes, ma'am, Beyonce.
Okay. There's two questions online, but they can be answered. I can't ask them in one. It's how do we develop relationships in church and what are some things we can do to welcome new members and have them truly feel welcomed?
I think a couple of things. I think we've created some, but I don't know if people have been taking full advantage. We created Soul Food Sunday for fellowship. But if you're the first person to hit the door, then do you really want fellowship? And so we've created other things, whether it's LOL opportunities or outreach opportunities that can develop into relationships. But the Bible says this, Beyonce, if you want to be want friends, you got to show yourself friendly. If you ain't friendly, how you gonna get some friends? We can create all the kind of atmosphere and all the kind of things, but it, and if you're not willing to, again, serving is always let me say it this way. Serving is never convenient. Sister Andrea jumped up Saturday morning with the boys, with the kids, so we were going to serve. They saw an opportunity to serve, and she's not a part of the youth ministry, but she saw an opportunity to serve, and she went, what? Served. Some people, part of our struggles as pastors, some people just waiting to be asked, and they see stuff that goes on. They know what needs to be done, but their baggage from previous churches, I don't know them people. I don't want to make myself vulnerable. So, in not making myself vulnerable, something does not get done that could be get done. I was teaching a workshop on Saturday, and one of the most powerful things I've ever heard, Brother Justin, was a person said, where do we start in doing kingdom opportunities? Not we ain't got the money, not our congregation is an older congregation, not who gonna do it. The question was, where do we start? No pastor and no congregation has a line out their door, people signing up to serve. Yes, ma'am, Beyonce. One that's growing in grace, one that checks on me and I check on them, that's not one-sided, that's a true relationship. If I'm always the one calling you and you don't never call me, what does that say about our relationship? If I'm always the one that's giving and you don't never give back to me, what does that say about our relationship? Is it one-sided or am I being pimped and played? And so I think you got to show yourself friendly. You have to put yourself out there. We have literally people who come to church every Sunday and doing the pastor piece of commitment and fellowship. They never leave their seat. They never leave their section. Or they go to the bathroom. We're not going to call no names, but he put his head down. And he don't even move that fast. But he purposely always got to go to the bathroom at that time, every Sunday. Almost 7 years later, still doing the same thing every Sunday. He's growing in grace in other areas. Somebody ought to say amen. We just got to get into growing grace that it's okay to say hey to some people. It's okay. I promise you, you won't get nothing on you. You promise you. You can't have a cold air Sunday. Questions? So the last couple slides and I'm finished. Yeah. So Paul's claim is that he set before people the cross of Christ in its simplest forms. To decorate the story of Christ with rhetoric and cleverness would have been to make people think more of the language than of the facts. What do I mean? It's just him and him crucified. Jesus don't need any chaser. He's straight. He don't need no Coke. He don't need no 7-Up. He don't need no Sprite. He don't need no orange juice. He don't need no cranberry juice. Did I call it all? Ginger ale. Did I call it all? Did I miss anything? Pineapple juice. Did I miss anything else? Orange juice. All right. Spritzer. Did I miss anything else? Club soda. Did I miss anything else? Red Bull. Y'all going all the way in. My Lord, listen. I'm out the game. I'm Red Bull. I mean, you bouncing off walls. Okay. Anything else? Any other questions? Questions, comments? Okay, so we're going to keep pressing our way. Yes, ma'am, Sister Cook.
Afraid to be in relationship or things like that. Sometimes I think maybe people don't jump in to do what's done because they have church baggage about being out of order.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean by
I agree.
Order?
Mm-hmm. I think to me, Sister Cook, to me, I'm the kind of leader that I'd rather you do something and then if you make a mistake, we'll talk about it.
Okay.
Instead of you scared to do something because I think I'm going to make a mistake.
But that's the thing, like being out of order in church or doing something that you didn't have any authority or permission to do. And I think sometimes maybe that keeps people from
Go back to that part, Sister Beyonce, where it's not the leader, it's the people who are around the leader. Where is it? The bullet. Okay, without their knowledge and without their consent, their names have been appropriated by the Corinthian factions. I say sometimes our supporters are a bigger problem than those who are openly hostile. It ain't the leaders who are putting these rules. It's other folks who put these rules and they ain't talked to the leader about it, who have turned people off. So we got to be careful. And I think pastors got to keep an open door and saying, if you got an issue, come talk to me. Text me. Call me. Some people say that I'm too open as a pastor. I disagree with that. There's too much access. I disagree with that. Because I think people, in my research of people, the reason why people don't go to church is they want a pastor who is accessible and available. They do not want a superstar preacher. They want somebody who gonna hug. They may be sweating out church, but funky, but they want to hug and just say, hey, mama, how you doing? Everything all right? I'm going through. Call me. Let's talk. Because for me, if I say call me and you never call me, then the responsibility is on you. I put myself and say, hey, if you need to talk, I'm here. But if you never call, then that ain't my fault. Beyonce, last question.
Isn't it wrong to be humble yet a faithful servant in a church in order to identify what kind of relationships are best?
Okay, make sure I'm understanding this. Read it again.
Isn't it wrong to be humble yet a faithful?
Is it wrong to be humble?
Isn't it wrong to be humble yet a faithful servant in a church in order to identify what kind of relationships are best?
Well, my question would be, how is it wrong to be humble, number one? And did the Spirit lead you to join the church? Because remember last week it said, God has saved us to serve. And so one theologian says, if you're not serving in a church, then you're really not the believer you could be. Because you're just taking and not giving. You're not all in. Okay? All right. Let's keep y'all. Bishop McKinley Young lifted in prayer. His family has asked the denomination to pray for him. So let's keep him lifted in prayer. His family, his wife, his daughters, his grandchildren, as he deals with some serious health challenges. And if y'all know me, for me to say this is a major growth for me. Okay? Major growth. All right. Let's keep Brother Thaddeus lifted in prayer. Let's keep others lifted in prayer. Brother Justin, again, still out of work, still got to go to work every day and get a 0.00 paycheck last week. And next week, going to get another one. Okay? But the president served McDonald's to the college football champions, the Clemson Tigers. And said, I paid for it myself. He put it on his gold card. All right. Let's pray. Gracious, wonderful, kind God, we thank you for an opportunity, God, to talk openly about the divisions that need to be healed. God, make us better disciples, better followers of you. God, we lift up Bishop Young and his family. We lift up Brother Justin and Sister McKinney and others who work for the federal government. God, strengthen them in the midst of their struggles. Remind them, God, that they have a place to go to, a pastor that wants to hear from them, whatever their needs are. We ask it all, Lord, in Jesus' name. We thank you for these who come. We thank you for those who worship with us virtually. We thank you, God, for how we've grown tonight. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Good night, everybody. Thank y'all so much for coming. Worshiping, those who worship virtually, thank you all for sharing.